welcome to Vibrations. I'm Raven Geary. This week, South Africans celebrated an unprecedented milestone when Nelson Mandela became the country's first black president. While most of us followed the historic event on television, two Tallahasseans got a bird's eye view of the events leading up to the big day. Dr. Walter Smith and his wife Geraldine recently took a trip to South Africa. They join us today to tell us about that and some of the great things that they were able to witness, and they're going to show us some special things as well. Thanks for joining us today.
We're happy to be here.
Good to be with you.
First of all, what was it like? Everybody's going to ask you, I'm sure, the same question. What was it like to be in South Africa, seeing all these great events taking shape?
It was exhilarating. We felt that we had had an opportunity to make a significant contribution, and we were both moved by having that kind of opportunity. We were involved in it. We weren't just there observing, but we were actually a part of it. As a matter of fact, the first week that we were there, we were being briefed for just about a whole week and given orientations. We had a code of conduct that we had to observe, and we needed to know information about safety and what the various risks were. And so we had a lot to learn just to prepare to go out to be international observers. There were about 1,000 people from the United States who were among those of us who were there to observe. And then from across the world, throughout the world, there were about 10,000 observers.
You were part of a very special team. Tell us about that, Dr. Smith.
Yeah, the African American Institute, which is one of the oldest nonprofit organizations in the country, which works in Africa, selected a 15-person team, their board of trustees did, to go and represent them as observers and monitors in this first democratic election. So we were among those. Two educators were selected, Dr. John Rose from University of Vermont, Jerry as a lawyer, I from Florida A&M University, and we had several chairmen of boards of major corporations, former ambassador. We had the former head of state of Nigeria, General Osabanjo. So we had a tremendous team of outstanding personalities who were selected by the Board of Trustees of AAI to go there. We, as Jerry said, we were briefed tremendously by the Ambassador of the United States, the security people from the U.S. Embassy, and we just had to be very, very careful as we moved around. As you probably know, shortly after we got there, we were about a block away from the first major bomb. Mm-hmm. The blast killed 12 people. There were 92 people hurt. The second week we were there, we were getting ready to go to the polling place, and a bomb exploded at the polling place. Nobody was killed because it was early in the morning. But we had to deal with very strict security issues while we were there because the far right was going to see to it that this election didn't take place. But it did, and we were a part of it.
Your husband lived for a period of time in Africa, but this was your third visit to the country?
I had been three times before. This was my fourth visit to the Republic of South Africa. I had gone during the time that he was there and had an opportunity to participate on with very august groups at Rhodes University and at the University of
Natal.
And we were dealing with affirmative action, and we were dealing with the dismantling of racial barriers. And they brought in people from other countries to talk about how they had dealt with it so that there would be some indicators for those people who are in the Republic of South Africa who are actively working with these kinds of things, that they could have the best path to reach the location they wanted to get to.
Dr. Smith, how did you feel about the process of those special moments, those changes that were happening in the country? You had lived there.
Yes.
So you have seen tremendous change.
Right.
Before your very eyes.
Yeah.
How did it feel?
Well, let me give you some historical perspective just for a moment, because I think that's very important. Many people might not realize that this election didn't just happen because some folks said they wanted to have a democratic society.
Mm-hmm.
In 1992 spring, April 17th to be exact, there was an all-white referendum called for where white voters, only white voters, determined whether or not there was going to be a democratic society in South Africa. And it was that vote that gave President de Klerk the authority to begin negotiating. They had two different conferences, CODESA 1, the Conference on Democratic South Africa, and after the referendum, CODESA 2. Well, it was from these two that the basic guidelines for the first transition government were established. So that just kind of sets the groundwork. Mm-hmm. Now, while there, then we were working on educational concepts so that voter education could take place. We were looking at the structure of higher education, secondary and primary education, and how that could be changed to meet the needs of all the people. And we were beginning to have people come to the United States, to Canada, to Great Britain, to look at the so-called great democratic societies of the world so that there would be some sense of what democracy would really mean ultimately. And all of that led up to this particular point.
With all of the excitement that we've been seeing on television and been hearing on the radio, there was a great deal of tension.
Yes.
With those ballots as they were being cast. Can you talk, I want to hear from both of you a little bit about that.
Well, there was tension, of course, prior to it, because we had to be alert to the fact that the right-wingers did not want it to occur. Mm-hmm. Then we had the special needs voting day, which was April 26th. And on that day, they were going to give special attention to voters who were infirmed, who were aged, women who were pregnant, and to prisoners. And unfortunately, much of the country was unable to have that take place because, for whatever reasons, when we're talking about getting ballots to primarily places where the Africans were going to vote, they did not show up. The ballot boxes didn't show up. The ballots didn't show up. And we found that it appears that they were being taken to a central location and then being farmed out. They were being driven around. And, you know, a vehicle could have had a breakdown or they didn't know where they were going. And what we had to factor into our consideration was the fact that the infrastructure for voting for whites was in place. But there was no infrastructure for voting for Africans because they had never voted before. So there were a lot of chinks in the chain. And some of it, we believe that it certainly was, that it wasn't intentional. Mm-hmm. It just wasn't well thought out. They had no idea of how many millions of Africans were going to come out to vote. And they didn't know where they were coming from. They had some idea, but eventually they added another voting day because they didn't take care of the special needs voters on the very first day, that meant that they had log jams on the second and third day. And so then they had, for many of the rural areas, they had another day, which was, I think that was on Friday,
yeah.
So that they could take care of them.
How to maintain the credibility of the polls, though, when all of this is going on?
Well, there are a couple of things that are very key to remember. Jerry mentioned Africans.
Mm-hmm.
That's very key to pigeonhole, because that doesn't mean all blacks. You see, South Africa had a tricameral government before: whites, coloreds, and Asians. The Africans were the only ones who were not a part of the government. So coloreds had a right to vote, Asians had a right to vote, whites had a right to vote, but never Africans.
It's important to define color, though.
That's what I'm about to do.
Mm-hmm.
Now, remember that blacks are categorized three ways in South Africa: African, coloreds, and Asians. Coloreds are what we call in America primarily mulattoes, who are the offsprings of indigenous Africans and either British or Afrikaners. The Asians, of course, are usually the Cape Malays or people who had come to South Africa from India. And they, of course, at one time were considered the servants, just as the Africans were. But because they were totally different and were imports, they developed a tricameral government comprising those three categories: whites, coloreds, and Asians. So, as Jerry was saying, there was no idea how many blacks would vote. As you probably know, over 22 million people were eligible to vote. Believe it or not, they had a voter turnout of over 96% of the eligible voters. They came in wheelbarrows, those who were crippled mm-hmm. and could not walk. They came on crutches. They came on donkey packs. It's amazing, in addition to walking. And for those who had other bikes and cars and things, they came that way. But to get back to your issue, there was a tremendous feeling of, I don't know whether to call it gratification on my part, when I saw all of these people coming to make a decision. And quite often, I feared for them. You see, the security was so tight that, remember, the voting process there was one where you used invisible ink to even stamp the ballot card, the identity card, so that nobody, when you got back to the farm, for example, if you lived on a white guy's farm who was opposed to the elections, and he grabbed a hold of your identity card to see if you went to the poll, he couldn't tell because invisible ink had been used. Yes, and the only way you could find it was if you used a special ultraviolet light. They also stamped your hand so that you couldn't vote twice.
What did you see in the eyes of the people as they were in part of this process? The fact that they were not only casting a ballot for Mandela, but a ballot for freedom.
Well, it was more than that. They were developing a government of national unity where not one person was going to make a decision, not one party. It was going to be a government where everybody had an input. For example, you hear them now talk about the big three, the National Party, and Carter Freedom Party, and the ANC. Mm-hmm. That's the big three because they make up the largest single bloc in the parliament. However, not one of those alone will be able to rewrite the Constitution or pass laws without input from the other and without help from the other. Now, back to your question about what did I see in their eyes? You saw anything you wanted to see. You saw tears, you saw smiles, you saw gregarious people, people who were walking with canes. You could see them just strut when they walked out the door. And you know, one of the things we heard so many times, is that all? In other words, for people who had never voted, they couldn't imagine after they passed that ninth station that all the hoopla about their voting and have a word in democracy would just amount to walking to nine stations, making a mark on two ballots, one for the provincial and one for the national government, and walking out the door.
Raven, let me tell you about a couple of observations I made. It was such a special day that we really could not truly, fully relate. At a nursing home that we was a polling place. I showed to my husband and to the other team member, there were three of us who were part of our team, this woman who had a very pleasant face, and she had on a pink After Five outfit. Her dress dipped to the floor in the back, and it was maybe three layers on the front. It was a hot pink After Five outfit, and she wore a special hair accessory in her hair.
I
was just shocked. But that said, it was a nonverbal form of communication saying this truly is a very special time.
I've arrived.
And then we went on to a community center, and there was a young lady, very attractive, and she introduced herself to me. She was also an observer, but she was from the country. And she wore a white brocade dress with a green shawl collar, and she had on green After Five shoes that she wore and had on a page boy a styled wig, mm-hmm. and she was just gorgeous. But that was saying to us, you know, this is so meaningful. And I sat then, and I really started paying attention. And some of the old men and the old people really did vote. It seems like the older they were and the sicker they were, the more determined they were going to vote.
That's right.
And these old men came in three-piece suits and ties and their Sunday going to meeting shoes. They were really looking good. They were just so elated and so proud to have this opportunity, and it meant so much more than we can ever understand.
We are That's relating true. A great deal of this process to what happened here in our country during the 50s and 60s. How was it as an African American to be in Africa?
At that particular time, it meant an awful lot to me in many ways. Back in the 60s, when we were going through some of the same kinds of changes and had some of the same kinds of experiences, I was a news reporter. And I had an opportunity to record history. And so while I was there, I was doing some comparisons and some contrasts. And there were many similarities. But I think that there were so many that were different. For instance, when these old people would come into town at 3 o'clock in the morning, and I understand that some even came in earlier than that, but at the places where we were documenting, that the earliest that they could say was about 3 o'clock, 3:30 in the morning, they were coming in from behind the hills and out, way out, and where we were was out, but they were coming in. And they would wait in line, and perhaps we would get to their polling station at 11 o'clock in the morning, and the ballots and the ballot boxes still would not have been there. And then maybe we'd go to another place and it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon. They still weren't there. And if they missed that day, they just got dressed and came back the next day.
Very, very determined.
Very determined.
Lines 3 miles long sometimes.
Yes, they would sit down on the ground and wait. There was no violence, there was no anxiety. They were just patient. Their goal was to make their mark.
That's right.
Speaking of the mark, the ballot being cast for Mandela, I want to hear from each of you your impressions of the new president and what you feel some of the challenges are going to be. First you, Dr. Smith.
I think that Mr. Mandela is a good choice at this time. He has the maturity. He's well educated. He has a sense of need for freedom. It's not easy for a person to sit in jail for 27 years and come out and become a leader. He has done that. He's transcended every conceivable concept of oppression to have the opportunity to lead in a free society. In my mind, there are some things that he has continued to say and do that make him very special. One is, and I don't know if you saw it here, but during the time there was the battle for including the Zulu king in the Constitution, he finally took the leadership role and went into Natal and yelled the Zulu salute, Bayete. All right? You are also my king. That said something to the Zulu nation. It was very meaningful because that had not happened before.
Also in this, we are looking at a mixture of democracy and communism. And I want to have Geraldine briefly address that.
Go ahead. I was going to say something about that, but that's all right. Go ahead.
How do you think about that? Because we're all looking, this is very unusual.
Yes.
Well, it certainly is unusual, and it's something for all of us to pay very close attention to. While Mr. Mandela has an awful lot of attributes, this one is going to be very unusual for him to pull off because his top advisors, while he was in supporters, while he was incarcerated, were communists.
And he uses the word comrade.
Comrade. Oh, yes. And his top advisors remain communists. As a matter of fact, during the politicking, the National Party, which is the party of Mr. de Klerk, had on their literature the fact that they were fighting against Mandela slash communism.
Yes.
And
it's
so now we do have some concerns there because, as I have said many times, I've never seen democracy and communism coexist. Now, I'm sure that he has an awful lot of support now from democratic societies. And if you watch the inauguration, and Walter and I were up at 4 o'clock in the morning so that we could see it live from South Africa, you would have seen Castro come.
Mm-hmm.
And he was not very warmly welcomed by
but
the crowd
there.
He was very prominently there.
Yes.
And that is something, that is a grave concern that we have to see how they're going to be able to reconcile that. Now, the other concern that I have about the leadership is that he's 75 years old. Now, the interim constitution and this period that he will serve is for 5 years. And I do wonder whether he's going to be able to hold up in terms of emotional stability, mental stability, and physical stability under the stresses that he's going to be under for 5 years. We have
to remember, also have a first lady of sorts where there is a great deal of controversy surrounding the relationship between Winnie and
Well,
Nelson.
She's not a first lady, though. Let's get that very straight.
I know. He has gone out of his way, from what the media is saying, to make it very clear that it is not.
Yeah, well, it's a most unfortunate situation. But they are unequivocally estranged. There's no question about that. And it's unlikely that she will ever be first lady of South Africa through his presidency. But I want to go back to something that Jerry was talking about that is underpinned by something else. And that is the structure of the presidency and the leadership is such that you have two executive deputy vice presidents.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's significant because the first person, Thabo Mbeki, is a very diplomatic leader. Level-headed, well-educated, and I think has the capacity and capability to step into Mr. Mandela's shoes if, God forbid, something should happen to him. And I think we're fortunate that if we had to go the third level, that we have a person in F.W. de Klerk who has now committed himself to a democratic society, and I don't think he would allow it to turn around. Of course, he'd have no choice.
Dr. Smith, do you fear assassination?
I fear assassination every day. I have feared it since 1990, February 1990, when Mr. Mandela was released. I pray every day that it does not happen because I think he deserves to be the president of the Republic of South Africa for a long time, if for nothing more than his suffering. Not only that, I think he can, in fact. He's not going to be able to do it in 5 years, as he has said, but I think he can, in fact, provide the leadership for upgrading the quality of life through different and better education programs, good health programs, good housing programs, being buttressed by good investments from people in America, West Germany, other parts of Europe, Canada, etc. So, yes, I have that concern, but I just somehow feel like God is going to provide the opportunity for him to have that long life and provide good leadership in South Africa.
Our guest today brought some very special pieces of memorabilia back with them. And before we go, I want to make sure that they have an opportunity to share some of these things with you. First of all, the pieces of cloth, which are just magnificent. I want to give you an opportunity to, which camera should we go to? We'll go to this camera to let you tell us a little bit about this. Now, on this piece, this is the symbol.
Yes.
This is the peace symbol.
The peace symbol.
The peace symbol.
Yes.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Peace in our land is what they call it.
Okay. And we also have the other piece, which features Mr. Mandela.
Yes.
Yes. And it's very colorful, and it's good for dashikis or for dresses or wraps. And
well, did you see a lot of stands with men? Because that's what we've been hearing. Everything's for sale right now.
Oh,
that's,
yeah. That's true.
Absolutely.
Everything's for sale.
Absolutely.
Everything's
for
even
sale.
The flag.
Everything.
You can't. They can't make enough of anything. And we were very fortunate to find this fabric before we left.
Two pieces were left in the big place that we were at.
As soon as it
rolls off,
it's
sold. As a matter of fact, I got this
sold.
The day before I left.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, what is not for sale is the tie that you're wearing.
That's right.
Tell
you
me
cannot,
about that.
You cannot buy this tie, no matter how much you want to. This tie was presented to me by the former chief minister. I say former because now he's a member of parliament. But the chief minister of the Zulu nation of KwaZulu, I call him His Excellency Mangosuthu Gatshebotsholetsi. I addressed the KwaZulu Assembly last year, and when I finished, this presentation was made to me, and I was flabbergasted because it's only given to special people, and it is not for sale in the stores. It is the official's tie, and if you look closely, you will see a beehive with the royal crown sitting on top of it. That's the symbol of the Zulu nation.
That is very nice. What are some of these other things?
Well, these are the kinds of identification pieces. Each time you saw us, we had this on, and another time we'd have this on, and then we'd have the cap on. As you can see, it says IEC, Election Observer, that's official, and the armband, you'd wear the cap, this, the armband, all the same time.
Mm-hmm.
So there'd be no mistake that you were indeed official.
women in South Africa. Tell me a little bit about that, Geraldine.
Let me tell you that they had platforms related to the rights of women and the status of women. And I also want to mention that we failed to mention that Winnie Mandela is a member of Parliament.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, she has continued to be a leader and she has continued to serve in elected positions. So there are some grave concerns, some real concerns about the status of women because they have not had significant roles to play in what's happening in South Africa and in the development of the new democracy, but their roles are improving.
Okay, and this is?
This is a sample of the ballot.
Do you plan a trip back? Are you going to go back over?
Oh yes, oh yes.
Definitely.
I'm trying now to decide when that's going to be. We're being pulled at right now. As a matter of fact, I've been asked to come for several things.
Okay, well, we hope to hear more, and thank you for joining us today on Vibration.
My pleasure.
Okay, thank you.